Yes. Good morning, Panos. Can you see us?
Hello, good morning. Yes, I can hear you. I cannot see you. Can you hear me?
Yes, we hear you very well. Thanks for joining us in this way. We had to improvise a little bit, but we are very glad that you can be with us today.
Well, thank you for inviting me, and I'm really sorry. I very much wanted to be with you today, but given the latest developments in northeast Syria, it was just impossible to be in Berlin today. I will share some reflections, really more from a field perspective. First of all, to say really what a wonderful paper it is, looking at the 10 ways to approach what people need, and I read it with a lot of interest. And of course, what I would like to do is just share some reflections on the Syria context. A fast-evolving operation, a fast-evolving emergency that is still, it's on its eighth year, not just a crisis, a protection crisis that continues to unfold, unfortunately, in a very dramatic way, as you've all followed in the last, actually, 5 days. So I started a job in Syria about 2 years ago, and indeed, one of the questions that was put when I looked at the response is, how do we make sure that in a $3.5 billion response, with about 350 partners, NGOs, about 10 UN agencies, how do we make sure that the response is relevant? How do we look at efficiency, effectiveness, and most importantly, in such a mega complex government, non-government, at the time we still had besieged, hard to reach areas, who do we help first, and what is really the top issues that we want to take forward? So we came up with two steps at the Syria Strategic Group meeting, which brings together the Damascus-based UN humanitarian country team with NGOs now, the cross-border from Turkey and the cross-border from Iraq. At the time, we had cross-border from Jordan as well. Two things we did. One is we introduced a prioritized severity scale, basically to be able to look at 12 million people and decide at any given time who gets aid first. And that severity scale from 1 to 6, we put at the highest level people who are newly displaced, hard-to-reach areas, people. And then the scale went down based on vulnerability and based on needs. It wasn't geographic, it was based on a very technical criteria, which meant that out of 12 million people in need, we could only help about 5 to 6 million every month. And that number, actually, who was helped, shifted based on that severity of need. I mean, obviously, like now, we've just had 200,000 people newly displaced in the northeast. These people become top priority. We've had an additional 400,000 in the northwest. These people became a top priority, and that meant that somebody else didn't get the assistance. We had to discontinue from somewhere to be able. And that, I mean, in the Syria context, I keep on referring it to the Rolls Royce of the information management, because information management and the communications, of course, with people to be able to assess their needs and understand who was on the highest ability was something really crucial. Now, in addition to that, we really looked more from a leadership perspective, and again, listening to or trying to listen as much as we could to people, what are the things that matter the first and most to be able to address on the operation? And we came up with four what we call the non-negotiables, and I just want to refer them very quickly. These four non-negotiables are actually in line with the ATT terms of preference. This is an IAC prioritization that we thought was very relevant to put it in this Syria context. The first one is the leadership on protection, the centrality of protection. The protection sector, of course, had their own analysis, that they did their own work, the protection lead agencies, the AORs, the NGOs, the retaliation of the family. But the question that came was really when we looked at the strategic, Syria Strategic Group meeting, what are the key action steps through quiet diplomacy, active public speaking, donor capital partnerships, linking to the political, linking to the non-state actors, and clearly the protection of civilians and the conduct of hostilities was the most critical issue throughout, and it still remains today, to be able to intervene, to ensure IHL implementation, to be able to look at how to prevent and how, of course, to intervene in a way that protection was dealt both at the leadership level and, of course, at the operational side in terms of protection mainstreaming, the practical response. there were about 16 protection priorities, and of course, out of the 16, we went for the two issues, the protection of civilians and the economic facilities, and then practically civil documentation and how to work through state, non-state actors to be able to move forward in the right way. So that was the first non-negotiable. The second non-negotiable was gender-based violence. We really put on the very top to be able to tackle it both again from a leadership perspective, but also from an operational side. So for every head of agency, NGO country director, had to make sure in operationalizing GBV that that was really taken as a top priority. The resources were prioritized, both prevention and response was dealt with. And until now, when we do our serious strategic group meetings, we meet every 8 weeks. Actually, we always have to have an update. How far have we gone? How well have we done? What is outstanding and how further to adopt it? The third area, and I'm trying to go very fast in terms of non-negotiables, was PSEA, prevention of sexual exploitation and abuse. Again, that was an issue that we prioritized at the very top, and we took the right steps in making sure that hotlines, complaint mechanism, training to staff, code of conduct, a whole range of activities. The most difficult, of course, is investigation and follow-up when an incident happened, but with a clear message from the leadership and a technical support. Very grateful, funding was an issue. We got resources very quickly to have a couple of coordinators. It advanced more in some areas than in others from a collective point of view. Every agency has taken it very seriously, and we maintain it at the leadership level. And the last point, but not least, and I would say the most important, is actually the question of accountability to affected people. So that was the fourth non-negotiable. Now, every UN agency and NGO do have a mechanism that feeds back to their own system organization. The issue we're trying to do here is to see how do we bring in a mega complex operation, make sure that when we sat at the strategic leadership level, we really knew and heard back feedback from the people in terms of what was the most important for them. But also feedback in different areas and different needs that evolve. The crisis in Idlib, the crisis at the moment in Northeast, is very different to what people need in other parts of the country, where it's less life-saving emergency and it's more protracted. And again, to be able to tailor-made a response. For me, the model was really to see a lot of what the crowdfunding solution has been doing and trying to see to what extent we can have a mechanism that feeds into the collective, because that's what we don't have at the moment. I think this is a weakness, not just in this operation, but globally. There's a couple of good examples, but as a system, we're still far behind to have a system that feeds back, not just to allow me to be critical, a mandate-driven approach or a specific organization approach, but a people-driven and bring it at the collective operation in a mega crisis like we've had in the Syria operation. And that's still a work in progress. I think we've made some steps, but not quite yet there in terms of where we are. I'll stop there for the brevity of time. Over to you, John.
Thank you very much, Panos. Great presentation, I think very relevant for this morning's discussion, and also as a comment and reflection on the background paper. Not least, I noted the need to sort of continuously monitor, follow the situation, and feed information back into the whole system to allow all actors to be able to respond and to adapt to changing circumstances.